Hello, welcome to Virginia Time Travel, your portal to Commonwealth's past, present, and future. Hollywood is oftentimes looking at different major historical events, and in creating their own stories of it, we sometimes seem to forget that Hollywood likes to create its own version of history, while the actual events of history are far more dramatic. Take, for instance, something that the majority of people who watch this program are rather well familiar with, that being the Cold War. The conflict between the United States and the USSR was something that, for literally an entire generation, the great fear was, it's the Russians attacking. Well, if you watch Hollywood, you'd swear the Russians were ready to go ahead and push the button pretty much at the moment of a sneeze. And for many people, that may have been very true. But sometimes Hollywood goes ahead and exaggerates the details. To help clarify some of the events of the Cold War, specifically that of the atomic weapons themselves, is joining me our guest today, Jim DePiro, who is curator of the Cold War Museum. Or John, excuse me, John. I'm sorry about that. But John, welcome to the show. And first off, you know, the Cold War Museum, obviously we know it's about the Cold War.
Yes.
But I don't know the first thing about the museum itself.
Well, the museum started in an interesting way. It all started in the cafeteria at George Mason University. And Gary Power's son, Gary Jr., was working on a degree there, and he remarked with a friend of his that no one was writing roadside markers for the Cold War. So they decided that day that they would do something about that. And they conceptually founded the Cold War Museum. For about 15 years, it was an online thing. Had no building. They sponsored anniversary events. They did the Spy Tours of Washington. But then about 3 years ago, it apparently was, the timing was right. So about 3 years ago, we went to a brick and mortar museum.
Now, when we look at the Cold War, you know, this is something that I myself remember from basically the tail end of the war itself, where it was pretty much assured the United States was going to win this war. We just didn't know when. Meanwhile, for those the generation before me who lived throughout basically the whole event, it was a question of when will the bomb drop? And so, you know, when we think about nuclear weapons, especially today with terrorism, what would you say is the biggest difference between, you know, the principle of a terrorist having it versus the Soviets during the Cold War? What would you say is the biggest difference here?
Well, that's an interesting question, because what you're doing is you're pulling the question into the present. Mm-hmm. And so what can we learn from the past about what's going on in the present? And that's very interesting. And indeed, it is the focus of our museum. Even though we cover the 50-year period that's the Cold War, all of our exhibits are then extrapolated to talk about what's going on in the present. So as an example, the first exhibit that you would see in our museum is dealing with civil defense. We actually have the civil defense headquarters for the city of Washington, D.C. set up in our museum. And when they closed the program down in the 90s, they said to us, you can take anything out of the building you want, and we went out the door with all the stuff. So we've rebuilt it there. Interestingly enough, we had an incident not so long ago where a civil defense capacity might have been very useful. And that was August the 11th at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, 2011. And what happened that day was the earthquake down in Mineral, Virginia. Mm. Now, it damages the Washington Monument 85 miles away. 11 miles away is is North Anna 1, North Anna 2 nuclear power stations. And so that whole thing then, the nuclear power station went into the emergency mode. They would shut the plant down. They would go on emergency power. A whole series of things happened there. Interestingly enough, there was no power outage. So all the work that they did programming computers, and this had to be done by a computer because it was too fast for a human being to do, went out all over the East Coast and said to all the other power producers, give us everything you've got. We're in a shutdown mode, and it all worked. So when you ask people what happened that day, they give you a quizzical look. Now, had that system not worked, then we may have needed a civil defense thing where we would have had teams who could go out and do Geiger counter surveys to figure out where the bad stuff is and where the bad stuff isn't, and how do we handle all that. Our capacity to do that was actually quite robust during the Cold War, and it's actually quite lean now.
Now, you know, considering that you said it's lean now and robust then, let's go back to the then. And, you know, let's start with the obvious question. World War II ended in 1945.
Okay.
You know, we've mm-hmm. beaten the Nazis, we've beaten the Japanese Empire, the United States, number one, world's at peace, huzzah, huzzah. And then all of a sudden, you got Churchill, Patton, MacArthur, they're all looking over at the Soviet Union, they're saying, we're still mobilized, let's go. So effectively, when does the Cold War begin?
The Cold War, a variety of people will give you a variety of answers. Our answer is that the Cold War begins the day we dropped the first atomic bomb. And here's the reason. There are only about 100 cities in Japan big enough to warrant being dropped a bomb on them. And so they had a committee who set the criteria, and the criteria was about 100,000 population. So what happened is that as the war was going on, the Allies would bomb these Japanese cities. When LeMay ends up in the Pacific, his lament is, we're running out of cities to bomb. They're bombing a city about every other day, every 3 days. And they actually have to save some cities to drop the atomic bomb on. So it wasn't the Japanese that we dropped the bomb for their benefit. The Japanese were already trying to surrender. The dropping of the bombs on Japan were actually for the benefit of the Russians. It was to tell the Russians, we have the bombs and we're willing to use them. So the real Cold War starts when we drop the first atomic bomb in Japan.
Now, once we drop the bombs, we become the superpower of the world.
Right.
And obviously, Joseph Stalin is thinking, well, I want that toy too, much like any little toddler who sees a kid with something else they want the same thing.
Right.
When do the Soviets get the bomb?
Well, there's a lot of history on that, okay? But let's kind of connect some dots. Let's kind of go big picture a minute. So we dropped the two bombs on Japan. We've got two spares. So Truman's president, he's president for about another 7 years. When Truman leaves his presidency, we have 1,000 bombs. 8 years later, Eisenhower leaves his presidency, we have 20,000 bombs. The United States would ultimately get up to 32,000 bombs. Now there's some definitional issues there. If you've got five components, does that equal a whole bomb? But basically that's about where we are. And we're about that way not so long after Eisenhower leaves presidency. Now, the Russians are trying to catch up with us, and so about the same time that we hit, they're going to hit about the same number. The Russians will build a lot of bombs. Both sides are up in the ballpark of 32,000 to 34,000 bombs.
Well, that would certainly wipe everything off the face of the earth a few dozen times over at this point.
Indeed it would. Indeed it would.
And we just think about the damage of one bomb again. I'm just picturing 32,000. All I just see is a little mini sun.
Imagine this. What if I came to you and I said I had 32,000 Volkswagens and I want to park them somewhere? Where could I find a facility big enough to park them?
Tyson's Corner.
So we're in these mega numbers is the point. So let's talk about another thing then. World War II ends,
right.
The United States goes out in the Pacific Ocean, mm-hmm. and we are starting to detonate now hydrogen bombs, not atomic bombs. First hydrogen bomb is about 1,800 times bigger than the bombs dropped on Japan, and it only uses half the radioactive material. So we're getting way bigger bang for our buck, okay? And that's what they're doing. And this is all going on out in the Pacific Ocean. So Bikini Island, those kind of places are where these hydrogen bombs are being blown up. Now, when they detonate the 29th bomb, a huge light bulb moment occurs. And the light bulb moment is strontium-90 in milk. Wait a minute, we're blowing these bombs up, the stuff is going up in the atmosphere, It gets rained out, the plants soak it up, the cow eats the plant, the kid drinks the milk, da-da. We've got radioactivity in the milk supply. So there's this flurry of activity. Treaties get signed with the Russians. No more detonating bombs in the atmosphere. You want to detonate a bomb, you have to drill a hole, go down about 300 feet, put the bomb down there, fill the hole, detonate the bomb. Nothing gets out. So we stopped it. We stopped that kind of detonation at that point in time. Now you have a problem. If you can't drill a hole down 300 feet in the ocean and put the bomb down there because it'll fill with water.
Right.
So they come back to Nevada. So it's Yucca Flats. It's about 120 miles north of Las Vegas, and they begin detonating bombs there. And we have a map in the museum of Yucca Flats, and it's got these red dots all over it. There's 837 of them, and every one of those dots is a nuclear detonation.
Well, I don't explain where the giant ants come from in all those B movies.
Indeed.
So they start showing up.
Indeed.
And so, you know, with those, that theme of the B movies of Hollywood comes out in the 1950s, 1960s. And of course, the big popular issue is the atomic weapon and all this radiation. And you brought up, you know, kid drinks the radioactive milk from the cow that ate the radioactive plant that got radioactive because of, you know, detonating in the atmosphere. You know, how obviously this became a big enough concern to create treaties with it. I mean, is this something where, you know, we started doing campaign ads, don't drink milk, drink something else, or?
Well, what sort of happens there is that they're doing the detonations out in the ocean, or out in the desert, and there's a lot of them. So, but eventually we get to September 1992, and what happens in September 1992 is another light bulb moment. Now, all nuclear bombs have got five components. So why are they blowing up all these bombs? Well, the reason is they're doing some engineering. So they're improving this component, that component, and then they need to test it to see if it's going to work. So they get to September 1992, and they're fooling around with the W-88 bomb. Nobody's ever heard of the W-88 bomb. But the smart guys are sitting in the conference room, and they say to themselves, we've reached 95% efficiency on all five components. Now we can spend another $1 billion to upgrade one of those components to 96% efficient. And what we get for it is another half a mile of tree blowdown. Is it worth $1 billion to spend that kind of money? And the answer is probably not. So they stopped detonating bombs. The United States has not detonated a bomb now since September of 1992. Now, they've got some computer systems where they can simulate all that stuff. But in terms of actually detonating bombs, they haven't blown up any since 1992. Now, there's some other things that are going to happen in here that we'll talk about a little bit more. But basically, what will occur is some things will happen that will result in START treaties and détente and a bunch of things that we've heard about with those terms. And they're all kind of fuzzy back then. But essentially what's going to go on here now is that it's going to start to impact on the number of bombs. So what we ask then is when Obama becomes president of the United States, how many bombs does the United States have? And the answer is around 5,000. You go, whoa, wait a minute. We went from 32,000 to 5,000? And the answer is, indeed, we did. Now, there's another intriguing question, and that is the next president, a year from now, based on our time, how many bombs will that president inherit from Obama? And there's a new treaty. The press doesn't cover much on this, but you got to pay attention to the ball on this thing to know what's going on. But somewhere a year from now, Obama leaves presidency. We're down around 1,700 bombs. Whoa. Big drop in numbers. Now, the Washington Post reported not long ago a Soviet compliance team in North Dakota looking at Minuteman missile silos. The silos are gone. The missiles are gone. The silos are full of dirt. We presume that there's an American team in Russia the same day. Probably so. So this is all being done as part of the current treaties. Not a lot of discussion going on about this. Okay, it's pretty quiet.
Yeah, it is pretty quiet. But, You know, we think about the fact that we've, you know, we escalated up to a certain point, and now we've, you know, de-escalated down to virtually nothing. So I guess the big thing is the event that started it all would have been from in the 1960s, John F. Kennedy's presidency, 1962, that being the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Yeah, we probably should talk about so there's a question, a Cold War question, which is, how close did we come to having an actual nuclear war? And so there were two primary times. The first of those was Cuban Missile Crisis. Now, it's not the part of it that you think about. What it has to do with is Kennedy draws a line in the sand, and he says to the Russians, you come south of this line, we're going to have a fight. The Russians have a sub south of that line already. So what will happen is the Navy knows exactly where she's at. They drop 5 destroyers on top of her. They start dropping practice depth charges in the water around her. She's an old technology Foxtrot class sub. And so she's down for about 2 days, and then the batteries go down to 1%. The temperature in the boat climbs to 140 degrees, and they've had it. The captain gets on the intercom and he says, men, this is the day we all die. They've got us. And he's got one nuclear torpedo on board. And he initiates a countdown, the fire of that one torpedo. On board the boat is a guy named Vasily Arkhipov. He's actually hitching a ride from Russia down to Cuba. Should have went by air. He'd have been there 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. He goes, wait a minute. The Russians' policy is that captain can shoot that round if he feels adequately threatened. But the Americans, only the president can release a round. So if you fire that round, the Americans will assume that Moscow authorized it, and Moscow won't survive the hour. So Vasily Arkhipov shuts down that nuclear release and probably saved more lives than any other human being in the history of the world. Hmm. We've talked to the guys at the Russian embassy about this. His birthday is January the 30th, and we said there should be a cake and a birthday, and we should commemorate this guy because he saved more lives than any other human being in the history of the world. The second time that it came close was, there's a book out called Red Rogue Star, and it deals with a rogue Russian submarine that actually fires a nuclear missile at Hawaii. Okay, U.S. official policy is they fired a nuclear round at Hawaii. What they didn't know is that Sam Nunn, senator, had put this program together to put fail-safe items on the Russian nuclear arsenal. And so at the construction of the missile, the black box was installed, the sub fires the missile, the black box explodes the missile as soon as the sub leaves the chamber. That's the sub that would ultimately be recovered by the Glomar Explorer, which Howard Hughes, actually it was Lockheed Howard, was a cover story. Mm-hmm. But they actually go, they build this huge ship and they go to the bottom of the ocean, 16,000 feet down, and they bring the Russian sub up. Mm-hmm. Now the cover story is they only got half of it up. There's some guys who are now saying, well, actually they got the whole thing up, they just don't want to tell the Russians that they did.
Well, understandably so.
Interestingly enough, they provide the Russians film of us burying their sailors at sea. Now they're radioactive because there was radioactivity on the sub. And they also provide the Russians the ship's bell. So just in case you thought that was a Hollywood production, they gave them the ship's bell to validate that, yes, indeed, we got that sub up.
Okay. Well, you know, because, you know, when we think about Hollywood, they do come up with their own different versions of history. One film that recently came out was Bridge of Spies. Indeed. And we were discussing that a little bit before the show. And you had mentioned one of the people involved with that program. It was also heavily involved with the museum, and that was Gary Powers Jr.
Yes, Gary Powers Jr. was the co-founder of our museum, and he's our emeritus, and we love this guy. And he helped work on the script. He went to New York and worked with the Coen brothers on the script for the movie. So what will happen is a thank you Disney and DreamWorks gave us 250-seat theater showing of the movie. And so it went out to our mailing list. So we had 12 U-2 pilots in the room. And in the movie, there's a guy, Lieutenant Anderson, whose job is to identify Powers when they're doing the swap. We had the actual Anderson in the room.
Oh, wow.
And we had Gary Powers' 2 kids, and then the daughter of the character that that Hanks plays, the lawyer, the actual daughter of the actual guy was there. So this was a really great event to get that many people together in the room at one time who are all part of that.
Now that had to have been just a sight to behold.
Yeah, it was.
And so, so when you look at the Cold War, I guess the big question right now is, where's the museum? You know,
yes. Well, it's an amazing thing. It's a crowdsourced museum. So all the exhibits in the building walk through the door. And the thing is, there are Cold War warriors all around here. And so they walk in the door and they'll look at a picture of something and say, I've got one of those in my garage. And the next thing you know, the next day we've got the item. So it's been a phenomenon. Mm-hmm. And a life-altering experience. So, for example, I had three ladies came in not too long ago. There was a grandmother, a daughter, and the granddaughter. And they said, do you have anything on the privateer? Well, the privateer was the first of the ferret flight airplanes that the Russians shot down. That was April 30th, 1950. And so we talked about it for a little while. Then the elder lady says, she says, now, you know, my husband was the pilot of that airplane. You go, whoa. But then she says, but his best friend came to him and said, can we switch missions? And his best friend took the mission that day to be shot down, never seen again. So then we started hunting. Well, then it turned out that there was a whole series of things that happened. Gorbachev comes along and perestroika and all that stuff. And so the wife goes to the Soviet Union. They put pictures in a couple of Russian magazines and they get hit. She goes to the prison that her husband had been interred in. And now the Russians go dumb on her. Mm-hmm. They go quiet. So what a phenomenon to have people. So our goal isn't to portray the hardware of the war. And we have several exhibits on airplanes that were shot down where we have pieces of the aircraft. To include the one that was shot down over Cuba in 1962, that's another time that we really came close to having a shooting war when the Russians shot that U-2 down over Cuba. They were within hours of launching a strike on the Soviet Union.
Wow.
When that happened, yeah. So this is great fun because every day, someone comes through the door of the museum who has a story to tell.
And so, now where is the museum located?
It's about 20 miles west of Fairfax here, out Route 66. So if you go to 66 and get 29 south, in a couple of miles, you'll come to Van Hill Road. Mm-hmm. Now we're on the old Van Hill Army Post, and that's a whole other thing that we could talk about, because what we haven't talked about here in this interview is we haven't talked about aliens, we haven't talked about flying saucers, we haven't talked about using a huge antenna array. It was 250 acres, it was 3,000 telephone poles that they used to track Russian submarines.
Oh, wow.
And even till this day, it's very quiet that any of that was happening out there. But the post itself, we're in one of the original three barns where they intercepted the purple code of the Japanese during World War II. And they decrypted all of that stuff. The post was the home of Monitoring Station 1. Mm-hmm. So Edward Snowden, National Security Agency, all that stuff flows right through those buildings.
Well, that's amazing to think, you know, that's just how close you are. And, you know, it's just like, it's kind of like, just like that way in the Cold War is the image of, you know, cornfield. And then all of a sudden out comes the silo and out goes the missile. It's
just exactly.
The day after, from the 80s when you saw that.
Sometimes people will say to us, were there any underground caverns? Where's the secret stuff? And we go, oh yeah, sure, right. And then a guy came in one day and he said, you know, I used to have an office right next to this window here, and I looked out at where this field was and there was some things out there. He said, when they're getting ready to close the base down, this cement truck pulled up and it dumped a load of cement into this hole in the ground. And he said, over the next 2 weeks, 200 cement trucks came out there and dumped all this cement down in there. And he said, I don't know what's down there. I said, neither do we.
Well, we now know something's down there.
But something's down there.
So, you know.
It took 200 cement trucks to fill the hole.
One can only imagine what's actually
Yes.
in there. Well, John, thank you so much for telling us about the Cold War Museum, at least getting us a good little scratch, a dig, a little hole in the ground, so to speak.
Come out and see us.
And we'd certainly love to come out. And we'd like to go ahead and thank you for coming out today with a small little token. It doesn't quite deal with the Cold War, but it certainly does deal with Northern Virginia, historic cemeteries in Northern Virginia.
Thank you very much.
Who knows, maybe somebody was being a cover story for the Cold War itself. You never know.
You never know.
But when we think about the Cold War, certainly the idea of the Soviet Union, the United States coming blow to blow and possibly delivering what could have been a nuclear holocaust is something that, well, every student does learn at one point in time in history. Whether or not they remember it and realize its importance is another story. But we hope today we've gone ahead and enlightened some folks about just how close we came to a nuclear war and the fact that you can learn more about it here in Northern Virginia. To learn more about the Cold War Museum, visit our website, www.timetravel21.com, or email us at timetravel21@yahoo.com. This has been Virginia Time Travel, your portal to Commonwealth's past, present, and future, reminding you that sometimes things aren't always as they appear to be. Thank you.